Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Good morning. What a wonderful time to be here in the presence of the Lord. You may have had a challenging week, but is the joy of the Lord in your hearts? Yes. What about up those in the balcony? Yeah. Has God been good to you? Yes. We are here to rejoice and we are here to give thanks. We are here to bless the name of Jesus. And as we enter into this time of worship, and as the Holy Spirit, we allow Him to captivate our hearts, and we ask for Him to turn our attention and focus our attention on Jesus, may our thoughts go to all that He has done, all that He has been, and all that He has for each one of us. And so may I invite you to join me this morning as we stand in His presence and as we prepare to sing our songs of praise and songs of worship. My only concern is that sometimes or many times we end up singing the words that we see up here, but it does not reflect our hearts. And this morning, my prayer is that as you sing these songs, let these songs be a reflection of your heart. Let it not be just some words thrown up there on the screen and somebody has put a tune to it, but let it be a reflection of our hearts this morning. As we come before the presence of our Father, we are not the audience. You are not the audience. We are not performers here. There is an audience of one, and all of us are here to present ourselves before that audience, Jesus Christ. And so this morning, even as we praise Him, even as we give Him glory for all that He has done for us, we praise Him and we give Him thanks for His goodness in our lives. Hallelujah. Can we take a moment and just close our eyes, everybody, and before we start singing, can we just lift our voices to heaven and give Him thanks? Can we take a moment and give Him praise? Can we take a moment and express our gratitude to the Lord today? Hallelujah. Come, Holy Spirit, come and have your way in this place this morning. Come and stir our hearts. And even as we offer our praises unto the Father and our thanksgiving to Jesus, I pray that you would help us to make this a meaningful time between us and the Father, between us and Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And this morning we pray that you would come have your way. Come have your way in this place. Hallelujah. Blessed be the. Let's sing unto Him and bless His name this morning. To God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin. And blessings. Thank him for what he has been to you and to me. Hallelujah. Oh yes, he deserves the glory and the honor and the praise. And this morning, that is what we want to give unto him. And so as we do, as we sing our songs, let it be with a joyful heart. And as we sing, lift our voices, clap our hands, and bless the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. We're going to praise his holy name. Lift him up above the heavens and praise his holy name. That's what the psalmist encouraged us to do. And we don't need others' encouragements. Let's just express our heart to the Lord this morning. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's sing unto him. Come on, put your hands together.
Lift him up above the heavens.
We praise His holy name. We bless His holy name. We magnify His name. We glorify His name. For the Lord is good. But besides that, we do so because there is no one else who is worthy of this.
Yes, amen.
There is no one else who compares to our God. There is no one else who is like Him.
Yes, amen.
God Himself says, "Who is like unto me?" And people confess and say, "Who is like the Lord?"
Yes.
The Israelites confessed it. There is no one like you. David confessed it. There is no one like you. The Old Testament patriarchs, they confess, "There is no one like our God."
Yes, amen.
And we recognize that today. We also say, "Who is like Him?"
Amen.
There is no one like Him. Hallelujah. And so as we sing the next song, let us declare this morning and say, "Lord, there is no one like you." Come on, put your hands together. Who is like the Lord? There is no one who is like the Lord. He is strong and mighty. Who is like the Lord? He is worthy. Stand up and give Him your praise. Sing it again. Who is like the Lord? We will bless Him. We will bless him. For there is no one like you, Lord. There is no one who compares to you. Seated in the heavens, oh Lord. Glorious in splendor. Glorious in splendor. Surrounded by light. Surrounded in your glory. Worship, for you alone deserve it all. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. Mighty are you, Lord. Oh, holy are you, Lord. Glorious, O Lord. Mighty are you, Lord. You are worthy. Something that we find in the book of Revelations. As we see the scene in heaven above, Revelations chapter 4. Revelations chapter 4, verse 11 is a declaration that is made regarding our God. And I'd like for you to listen to what it says.
You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. Amen.
By your will they are created. For your pleasure they are created. Everything that was created is created for one purpose, to worship. Even all creation, even the mountains and the hills we read about in the Old Testament, the trees clap their hands, the hills and the mountains, they lift up their worship to the Lord as they stand in grandeur and in glory, their own glory. All the birds, all the animals, the cattle and the field, they all lift up their worship to the God who is worthy of it all. And man, who is the greatest creation, we lift up the greatest form of worship unto him. According to Paul, who says, this is your spiritual act of worship. And this morning, let us confess, let us recognize that this is the purpose for our creation, for us being created. It is to bring him pleasure. It is by his will. It is to make him happy. It is him to feel pleasure because of us. And so this morning, as we confess, saying, I was made to worship and to bless your name, I will bless you at all times. Hallelujah. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Thank you. that true for you?
And I was made to worship. Oh, I was made to worship. Oh, I was made to worship.
Lift your hands to heaven as you say,
I was made to worship.
Come on, everyone, everyone, lift your hands, lift your voices and say,
I was made to worship.
Oh, I was made to worship.
I was made to worship
the living God, the living Lord.
I was made to worship.
We were made for His pleasure, for His glory.
I was made to worship. I was made to worship.
To glorify you through my life.
I was made to worship.
Worship you, Lord.
Glorious Lord,
mighty God, eternal King.
I was made to worship you, Lord.
I was made to worship. Where the presence of the Lord is, there is healing. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is liberation. Oh, where the Spirit of the Lord is, where the worship of God rises up to Him, He comes down and takes His place upon the throne. He comes down and takes His place amongst His people. And that is why we worship Him. That is why we lift up our voices, we lift up our hearts, we lift up our hands to Him. We want Him to come here. We want Him to be present here. We want His presence in His place. We want His presence here in our midst. We want His presence to come and touch us. We want His presence to come and cleanse us. We want His presence to come and remove all bindings. We want His presence to come and liberate us. We want His presence to come. We want His presence here. We want His presence here. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Your presence is what we need. Your presence is what we seek. Your presence is what we desire. Your presence, O Lord. Your presence in this place. Your presence, O Lord. Your presence, O Lord. Your presence, O Lord. Your presence in this place. Oh, your presence in this place. Your presence in this place. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Won't you come? Won't you be here? Won't you be here in this place? Come, Holy Spirit. Come and be present here. Move in this place. Move amongst us. Move within us. Stir up our hearts. Even as we are in your presence, as much as we are before the table of the Lord, as we prepare ourselves to participate in this, O Holy Spirit of God, help us as we examine ourselves, to see if we participate in this in a worthy manner, if there's something that you want us to set right, bring it to our attention. Show us. Convict us in our hearts so that we can rectify it, we can correct it, and then we participate in this. Come, Holy Spirit. We thank you. We bless you. This morning, we give ourselves to you. May this service be a blessed one. May it be a meaningful one. Let it be a powerful one within us. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Amen. And as we give unto him, we're also going to be blessed by a special song that's going to be presented by Samantha. She's been wanting to sing for a few weeks now. I've been putting it off, but today she's going to come and sing. So come, babe, come and sing.
Praise Lord, church. It's such a joy to be in the house of the Lord. Today I'll be presenting a song, and this song is a prayer. And please feel free to join in. So,
everything is pointing to one truth, that what the Bible has been telling us being fulfilled, and we don't have a long, long time to be here on earth. So be ready. Do not neglect, don't take this Sunday morning gathering for granted. Oh, if I don't go, I can come next Sunday. Who told you you can? If you can, thank God for His mercy. Take seriously our faith. Take seriously our relationship with the Lord. Take seriously about our gathering together. And I feel so, and I am a person who never in my ministry here canceled anything, not even the Bible study. Even if there is only one person, I would still have the studies going on. But nowadays, it is still on YouTube, it is still online, but I like to change it. Whether only one of you come, two of you come, that's enough. And so, and when you come for the Sunday service like this, and especially today we have the table of the Lord, I do not know how much preparations you have done. Have you been praying for today's service? Have you been seriously considering to attend the table of the Lord? Are you ready and prepared spiritually, mentally, and emotionally? We take so many things for granted and thinking we join with the crowd that Peter mentioned in his second letter concerning the second coming. There would be scoffers and there will be people who will say, hey, we have been hearing it for the last 2,000 years, but nothing happened. But people don't remember what the rest of the passage says. It is the long suffering of God. It is the patience of God. Not willing for a single person to perish, giving another opportunity. But then God has a time set. So may I say that we take the church little more seriously. And it is a shame that all over India, in all the churches are open 24 hours. Every day, prayer meetings happening, hundreds and thousands of people gathering. And we are just satisfied by coming just one time a week, and that too just for 1.5 hours. My friends, suddenly things will begin to happen and it is all over. And we will regret the opportunities we missed. Not because we didn't have the opportunities, plenty of opportunities to come together. Because our priorities are our ulta pulta. It is time for our set our priorities right. What is important in life? What is important? Education is important. And our children do well, that is important. But there is something that you need to put above all this. That is our relationship with the Lord and our responsibility as Christians. We need to be witnesses. We need to preach more. And for that, we need to pray more together. And we need to fast more. We need to come together in prayer. This man of God who will be here next Sunday, Paul Thangaya, he has a church of now about 30,000 people. And he has started a prayer meeting 4 years ago. Every day, not one or two, but thousands of people come and pray. And it is still going on. Every day, 24 hours. Churches are growing in many, many places because people are willing to make sacrifices. We have not learned to give generously, sacrificially. I'm not talking about money, but ourselves and time. It is so vital and important in these last days, if you believe the Bible. You know, in a number of ways, Revelation is a very special book. Very special. And it is becoming alive more and more, right in our eyes, the messages in the book of Revelation and in the prophetical books of the Old Testament, especially the book of Daniel. A man to whom God has shown through these many centuries of the world until the eternal kingdom is established in the book of Revelation. We have all these things before us. And we also are beginning to think, we have been hearing it for 2,000 years. It is not going to happen in our lifetime. You are wrong. So don't be deceived. And when the Lord comes, let him not find us sleeping. Revelation is the only book in the Bible that motivates its readers and should be, and therefore, its readers are so motivated when you read the book of Revelation seriously and give attention to each verse that you read. And there are so many promises, a blessing to those who read and obey the book of Revelation. That's what it says. Not only the blessing to those who read and obey, but also a curse to those who tamper it. So simply because you think that you don't understand many things, you don't understand because you don't read. And that is why it is important for us to hear the reading of this book and also listen when it is read. And when something is spoken from the book of Revelation, listen very carefully. Revelation chapter 22, verses 18 and 19 says, there will be a lot of scripture verses today, and don't worry about the time. We have 24 hours a Sunday, and Sunday, the whole day is to be given to God. All right. Revelation chapter 22. What does it say? Verses 18 and 19 says, I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds anything to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. And if anyone takes words away from this book of prophecy, God will take away from him his share in the tree of life and in the holy city, which are described in this book. You know, in the Garden of Eden, there were two trees, the tree of distinguishing knowledge and, I mean, right and wrong. what is right, what is wrong. There was also another tree, the tree of life. And that earthly garden is gone. You will not find there this tree today. But the original tree is still there in heaven. And that will be the tree, there will be, it will be there in the eternal kingdom of God. And that tree keeps our life eternally sustained by eating from the fruit. That's what it says. If anyone delete anything, not even a word from this book, or tamper with this book, what will happen? Such a person will lose the privilege of participating the fruit of it from the tree of life. And that means you don't enjoy eternal life. Very serious. And it is therefore very important for us to consider what the book of Revelation says. And I try my best to let you know what the book of Revelation is all about. It is a sobering thought, these verses, and should be considered by all seriously what the message of the book of Revelation is. Especially those who do not believe in the accuracy of the prophecy. There are many people don't believe. Many people don't believe that the book of Revelation is to be studied or to be known, because it's not true. So when it is time for us to stop treating the Bible carelessly, believing certain part of it, not believing certain part of it, then whatever is given us, it is very important for us to consider. So, you know, most people like positive motivation better. And Revelation has that in abundance for us to live and prepare ourselves to meet the Lord. You know, in this book of Revelation, there are 7 blessings are given. Chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. The time is near. Chapter 1, verse 3. And then chapter 14, verse 13. Then I heard a voice from heaven say, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labor, for their deeds will follow them. What deeds will follow them when they die? The deeds that we have done for the expansion of the kingdom of God. In other words, by preaching the gospel and bringing people to the kingdom of God. Such people. When I say this, why do I read it? I want you who attend my studies and exposition of God's word to you may not lose what otherwise you could attain. Your deeds Not what you have done for the earthly life, for your children and all kinds of deeds we do. We are so much concerned about children's marriage and children's education that we all want our children to do well. Let me tell you, if you do not care for the well-being of their relationship with the Lord and their spiritual life, you will lose it all at the end. Make sure that you give more importance to your children's growth in the knowledge of God and in the worship of God. And as long as they follow the Lord, it doesn't matter if their grade has gone down. That grade will never take them into eternity. But what takes them and give them a good standing before God is how they lived their life as Christians in the relationship with the Lord. Yes, we all have dreams and desires. But the greatest dream will be that in the kingdom of God, when it comes, I want all my children to be there. It doesn't matter. I have seen parents like that. I have a friend today who lived in America from Kerala. His wife also is from Kerala. They had 2-3 children. Even while they were staying in America, they practiced to eat Indian food only, with spices. He was a businessman. He had plenty, he was making plenty of money. But one day God told me, you leave all this and go back to India. And he came. Today he is working with churches. And another man I know, a big multi-millionaire, he was in Canada and in America making millions and millions. But when his children was growing up, he brought their children back to India for their education. Live in India. Today he is serving the Lord. And they live in India. What is important? You know, living in America, very comfortable. But the parents knew if they follow the American culture only, they will be lost. And so what deeds must follow you and will follow you? Not anything you have done in this world for the world and achievement and all these sort of things. It will all be lost. We leave all these things and we go. But what we have done, only one life and it will be gone very fast. Only what you have done for Jesus will live on and follow you. Here you go. So how to be rich and what is true riches? So let us follow the biblical instructions of how we must live and what should be our relationship with the Lord and what should be our relationship with the riches of this world. And so here it is, your deeds will follow them and your labor will follow you. The labor you have done, you have did for Jesus Christ and the kingdom of God. The contributions you make for the growth of the church. And my friends, you know, we have been, for the last two years, we have seen only departures from this church, so many. And as our young people get little education, they think they are now good only for foreign countries metropolitan cities in India. They're all leaving. I mean, I don't blame them. But I tell you, it is the parents who should instill in them a value system. What is important in life? The third blessing, behold, I come like a thief. And that is what is going to happen. That's how we will be taken by surprise at the coming of the Lord. Because those who are ready, living every day, getting ready and improving on our readiness, they will be gone. Hallelujah. But many will say, yeah, they are still getting ready. The church will be gone. And the following Sunday also will be there. The Sunday Christians all will be there in the church. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. If you are ready, and if you are getting ready, and if you are prepared, you will be gone when that moment comes, because it all will happen in a twinkling of an eye. Amen. And that those who are ready, whether in the morning or noon and evening or midnight or any hour of the day, it can happen, and it will happen. He says, I will come like a thief. Blessed is he who stays awake and keeps his clothes with him, so that he may not go naked and be shamefully exposed. Revelation 16:15. What is the clothes that John is talking about? Not this Raymond and water companies. When I need it, it won't come to mouth. All, I'm looking for the special, costly material, clothes, anything. That is not the cloth that you are talking about. The Bible in Revelation talking about the cloth. Keep your cloth ready so that you will not be naked. That means clothes. The Christians at that time would be wearing the cloth of righteousness of God. Clothed with the righteousness of God. That is a heavenly garment. The fourth blessing. Then the angel said to me, write, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And he added, these are the true words of God. Revelation 19:9. You get ready to receive such an invitation. That is the most important thing. So many this year seem to be a lot of weddings coming up all over the place. And how we prepare ourselves to attend that wedding. All we keep our best dress and blessed sari, blessed kapdas, you know, that the wedding. Because there are a lot of people will be there, they all want to see how I am dressed. Now listen. The church is the bride of Jesus Christ. And how many of you believe that Jesus Christ, according to his promise, is right here this morning, where two or three gathered together? I have a short message on that, which I will give you later. If that promise is true, and I believe it is true, the only condition is we meet in his name, for his glory, for his honor. He in his presence, to appear before his presence, is the greatest privilege that you and I have. There is nothing more important than that. Have you thought about it before you come? Where am I going? I'm going into the house of God. For what? There, God is going to meet with me in a very special way. That is why this gathering, you know, I will, he sits there by your side. The next blessing, blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection, and the second death has no power over them. But they will be priests of God and of Christ, and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Revelation 26. That is about the kingdom of God, for 1,000 years reign. Chapter 20, verse 6. And the sixth promise, blessing. Behold, I am coming soon. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy in this book. Revelation 22, verse 7. And the seventh blessing, blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life, and may go through the gates into the city. The tree of life. Adam and Eve were not privileged to eat from this. And the reason they were cast out of that garden, as soon as they ate from the other tree, but if they would continue to stay there, surely one day very soon they are going to go and pluck a tree of life and eat as sinners. And they will ever live as sinners. It is God's mercy that he cast them out. But that original tree is still there in the paradise. Did I speak here in a heavenly paradise here one Sunday? No? Next Sunday we have preachers. The general's chairman of AGI and the general secretary will be there together. And we will let him preach. And then the following Sunday, probably I will speak on the heavenly paradise. Here are the blessings. Chapter 22, verse 14. That's what I read. His majesty and the blessings. It is too amazing that this God should love us so much. Not only has blessed us with his salvation, including the forgiveness of sin and the redemption and eternal life, but then he keeps on adding to us blessings after blessings if we live in that relationship with Him in obedience and honor Him in everything. Nothing reveals the majesty of this book as does John's reaction to the personal revelation of Jesus Christ in this book. The record says, when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet in a dead condition. Take it seriously. That is the majesty of his presence. We have not come to a very ordinary person. Remember that. If he is to reveal his physical glory, none of us will be able to sit here. But he is here in a concealed manner. But we experience his presence, the power of his presence, and the blessings of his presence as we experience the joy and the healing and the peace that passes all understanding. And so when John saw Jesus physically, he fell like a dead man. Have you ever known anyone fainting while bowing to the king and queen of England or some other monarch? Usually it doesn't happen. And John was so overcome, he simply fainted. And when John saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. How did Jesus react to the fainting of John? He was still, silent, as if he was dead. How did Jesus react to that? He must have smiled as he looked at his beloved disciple, the one whom he loved the most. And he tenderly put his hand on him and told him not to be afraid. And then John woke up. Have you seen Jesus of Revelation? Not really. But whatever we can understand and grasp by reading the description of how he appears today in heavenly places in chapter 1. Read that passage. Reading from verse 12. There's a description of Jesus' appearance today in heavenly places. And it is in the presence of this Jesus of revelation that you and I are here today. Have you seen Jesus of revelation? I ask again. He is not the humble carpenter with the toughened hand and with the worn out sandals. And with face that over which the perspiration, the sweat flows. You will not see that Jesus now. He is His Majesty, the King Jesus. Hallelujah. His Majesty, the King Jesus. Lift up our hands and say, Lord, I am in. Just realize the privilege I have the privilege to be in the presence of the majesty, the King Jesus. He does not say, we will be king. He will be king. He did not say he will be king. But he is the ruler of the kings of kings, all the ruler of the kings of this earth. And he is the King of kings and Lord of lords. Kings rule us. The Lord rules us. But our Lord Jesus Christ is the King over all the kings and all the lords. It is in his presence that we are today. No longer that humble carpenter's son, a servant, King of kings. We have known him in different titles, in different books. He is the King of heavens, Daniel chapter 4, verse 37. He is the King of king. He is King of Jews, Matthew chapter 2, verse 2. He is the King of Israel, John chapter 1, verse 49. He is the King of ages, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. He is the King of glory, Psalm number 24, verse 7. He is King of saints, Revelation 15, 3. He is the King of kings, Revelation 19, 16. And let me remind you, my dear friends, of the characteristics of the present generation. Compared to this, the proud, arrogant people of this world. Read this passage found in 2 Timothy chapter 3. The accuracy of the Bible and its prophecies truly amazes me. 2 Timothy. Chapter 3. The characteristics of today's generation. Verses 1 to 5. But mark this. There will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive. I will tell you what it is. Listen to this, the whole description. Lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power to change them and to transform them. That is the characteristics of today's generation. Any doubt? What accuracy, what perfect description of today's generation. Today, we are concerned about who is in charge of the nations of the world. We believe if the right person is selected, or elected, and the wrong one ousted, the world will be better. Let us say, granted. But these are only worthwhile bondages for a wounded, broken world, not the cure. No matter who comes, a worthy person, a worthy king, a worthy president may be there, but they can never cure these characteristics of today's generation. Our young people, my children who are listening to me, don't make yourself one of them. They may be abusive, they may be disobedient, they may be disrespectful, they may be slanderous people, without love, selfish. But you don't need to be like that. You don't have to be one of them. And young people today find it very difficult to be different. Because how can I be different when all my friends are like this? I will be an outfit. And you don't want to be an outfit. Eh? Oh, misfit. So thank you. I don't know, outfit, misfit. Yeah, misfit. I still need to take some English classes. Dare to be different. That's what God expects of you. Daniel dared to be different. Joseph dared to be different. The three Hebrew children dared to be different. Thousands and thousands of people were standing there. In the midst of them were these three children. They dared to be different. What was the result? Even the king has to bow before them at the end. Remember, children, you honor God and God will honor you. You don't have to be like others. You can be different. It is expected of you to be different. If we didn't know that Christ was in charge, we would be frightened. As the bizarre murder stories accelerating, global contaminations and all these things, collapse of personal moral values blare at us each day, everyone's question is, where is the world going? Where is the world heading to? And when that kind of thing, questions come, I have an anchor. I suddenly remember of the King of Kings, who is my Lord. He is in charge. He is in control. Now you be willing to be under his control. Then you will not be frightened. Some may think God is powerless. And that, you know, there are people are saying, now God, what God? If there is a God, he is so powerless. He can't do anything. And evil rulers guide the destiny of this planet. But friends, things are not what they seem. Today the evil seem to be ruling and winning. But the reality is something else. Jesus is Lord. He is still on the throne. And He will remember His own people. And those who belong to Him, He knows how to take care of them, how to protect them, and how to prepare them. So be followers of the good and followers of our God and our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. Honor this book. Respect this book. See, take this book very seriously and let not your actions and behavior. You are troubled by seeing the conditions of this world and the people. If you keep on looking, you also will become one of them and be lost. But the reality is, Jesus Christ has already told us, what can we expect as we come to the end of this age? And that is exactly what we are seeing. Get ready. Would you stand with me?